Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our not so much, no, it's not our Bible teaching snippet. Did you know I've been uploading videos and teachings for a little over 2 years now to Facebook and YouTube? And every single time that I go to hit that little record button right there on my iPhone, I automatically spill that phrase out, okay? But I'm not doing a Bible teaching today, okay? What I want to do is just kind of pick up where I left off yesterday. 2 days ago, I gave you an updated account of my salvation story where I got radically, radically born again in my mother's hospital room. I talked about that, and then yesterday I just exposed some very intimate things, okay, surrounding that event. But today I want to just go a little deeper. I think that sometimes it's good for people to drop their guard down and let other people in and let them have a more close-up, intimate look at who they're listening to. So I'm okay with doing that. I don't want you to think that it's about me and that I'm trying to be self-centered. I just think sometimes it's really, really healthy for people to know a little more about us. I consider many of you good, close friends, and you are my beloved. So I'm just going to do a little more talking today about my salvation and some events that around that, okay? I want to go back to, because one of the viewers said that she loved my heart because she could tell how much I loved my mother, and I want to talk about that real quick, okay? Before my mother went into an assisted living home, and I want to tell you about that, but she had gotten more and more disabled over time, and she couldn't work anymore, right? And she didn't know how she was going to ever live and take care of herself. And the last time she was in the hospital, I said, "Mother, don't worry. I will take care of you." So my sister helped Becky, the one that has always helped me with Mother. We found some land, just walking distance pretty much, I mean, from Becky's house. So she could go over and check on Mom if we got that land. So we bought the land, and then I'm out of town on a business trip, right? And they went and picked out a mobile home. And I just told them, I said, "You just get something she likes, and I'm going to take care of everything. You just make sure that she's taken care of." And I love her for doing that. My sister Becky was so good about helping us get her settled in. So we did. We got the land and got the mobile home set up. It was her little dream house. And then my husband and I went over, and we built her a front porch and steps and everything on it. And she lived there for a while, but then as she started getting worse, she was scared to stay alone, really, okay? And we ended up moving her to an assisted living facility. But before she moved, I would literally go and get her. Now, I lived and worked well over an hour away from her, and every Friday I would go get her, and I would take her out to her favorite restaurants, which would be a little Mexican restaurant or to Applebee's for baby back ribs and all of that. So, and then when it was pretty out, I had a convertible, and I would let the top down, and we would ride around in the country together, going really, really slow so she could just enjoy the wind blowing through her hair. And she was so beautiful just to see her enjoying that, and she loved to look at flowers and stuff as we drove. One day we were going down the road, and she kind of teared up, and she said, "Faye, I'm just so scared." And I said, and I've got her by her hand, and I'm like, "Well, what are you so scared of, Peggy?" You know, I always would smile at her and call her Peggy. And she says, "Well, I'm just scared my feet are going to be cold when I'm in my casket. I'm going to be in there, and I'm going to be cold." And I just smiled at her. I said, "Well, Mama, what would you like me to do? Do you want me to get you some socks to wear, and that way your little feet won't get cold?" And she said, "Yeah, that would be good." I said, "Well, don't you worry. I'll take care of that." So that was one of the things that I remember about riding around in the country with my mother with the convertible top down. But let me fast forward to the assisted living. She had gotten to a point that at night her blood sugar would drop and it would scare her, but she'd be so confused that she didn't know how to get to the peanut butter or whatever was on her nightstand to get her leveled off, and she was just living in constant fear. And My sister told me, she said, I don't know what we're going to do. She doesn't want to move, but she's scared to stay here. And I said, well, okay, next time I come, I'm going to talk to her. And I took her by her hand that day. And I said, now, Mama, I need you to tell me, what do you want me to do? I'll do whatever you ask me to do. If you want to stay here, I'll make that happen. And if you want to go live somewhere where there's other people, I'll make that happen. But I want it to be your decision. And sure enough, she agreed that she would go and look at a couple of three places. And we went to a place, and she ended up meeting some really great people. And we stayed there for well over an hour, maybe 2 hours. And she was so happy about moving there. But when I talked to her about it later, she's like, well, I really don't want to give up my little place. I said, but Mama, you can't live in fear. You can't do that. And so she said, but that little room, it's just a little bitty room, and there's no bathroom in it, and I just don't know if I can make it to the bathroom. And just she was just, and I told her, I said, well, I tell you what I'll do. I'll just rent two rooms, and I'll remodel them together, and I'll make you a flat. And you'll have a living room, a little kitchenette, and your own private bath. Would that make you happy? And she's like, you would do that? And I'm like, well, absolutely I would do that. Would you be okay with that? And sure enough, I called the lady that ran the place, and she said, oh, yeah, we'll be happy to let you do that, and because we're trying to remodel the rooms anyway, and if you will do that, that would be great. Okay, so we did, and I got her beautiful little place set up. And this is what's so wonderful. My mother met her very best friend, Miss Flo. They just laughed and played, and they watched TV together and watched the Gaithers and just all kinds of stuff. They'd go out on the front porch of that place and swing in the swings. And they these two women would get to laughing and playing so much, one of them would pee their pants from laughing so hard. Flo would always go in Mother's room and get her and take her down to eat breakfast and lunch and dinner, and she would kiss her on her forehead and tuck her in. My mother was so, so happy living in that assisted living. So the next thing I want to do, though, is talk to you a little bit about yesterday when I closed. I said that my husband had been so good to me and that he had never opposed me and my passion for Christ and pursuing Christianity. I can remember, well, I had been a believer for about one year. And we're out on the patio together, and we've always done this. We sit together and hold hands and rock, and we just watch the hummingbirds, we watch the sunset, and we just have a wonderful relationship. And one night, I was sitting there holding his hand, and I kind of teared up, and I looked at him. I said, I need to tell you something, baby. And he said, okay. And I said, you know, I needed you to know that the old Faye's not ever coming back. And she's gone, and this is who I am now. And if you don't want to be married to me anymore, I understand, because this is not who I was when you met me, and this is not what you bargained for. And if you do not want to live with me, I understand, and I will not be mad. And if you want a divorce, look, you just tell me what you want. You can have everything. I promise I won't be mad. I said, because I know it's not fair for me just to change and you to be stuck with me. But I'm not going to go back to who I was. The old Faye is gone, and this is the new girl, and you're stuck with her. And he just leaned over, and he had tears too, and he said, I love the new Faye. I don't want the old girl back. I want the new Faye. You're okay. I don't want out. This is good. I love you. So anyway, just so you know, I just felt like that it wasn't fair for him to be trapped in a relationship. He and I both were so reprobate when we met. And I mean, I cussed and I drank, and it was bad, guys. And then I just bail out on the guy. Now I'm just the, you know, little miss I love Jesus, right? But anyway, I told you that he was so supportive. Let me tell you some things about that. Do you know, I became a youth leader. I'd been a believer for 18 months or so. And this man of mine would come in the kitchen and help me make chili and soup and tacos and all kinds of stuff, and help me load it in the car and take it. And sometimes he would come to the cookouts and the little bonfires and stuff. He would actually make a show, and he is so very not religious. He does not get into all of this junk, okay? And he loved me so much that he would actually go to church with me, maybe a couple of times a year, just because he wanted me to know that he wasn't against what I was doing. And he absolutely loved the youth kids. But, you know, as time went by, I would start complaining to God because I would be with him and he just would cuss and just, ooh, it was bad. And it was really hard for me to connect and communicate with him. And look, I'm going to teach you something today. If you have to complain, complain to God. Don't complain to your friends so somebody can agree with you. God loves you. He wants the best for you. He's not going to betray you in what you say, okay? So I'm complaining about how I can't live with this man with him cussing all the time, that I can't even sit in the room with him. And what I do is I would just let him talk, and I would just get up and say, well, baby, I'm going to go to bed now, and I would just kiss him and tell him I loved him, and I would go in the bedroom. And I never argued and fussed with him. My soul and my spirit just couldn't handle that, and it was just really something I couldn't handle anymore. And so I would just be sweet and loving and go to my room. So anyway, I'm complaining to God, right? And God says, well, Faye, what do you want him to be? What do you want? And I said, well, I want him to love Jesus. I want him to have a passion and really get on this journey with me. And I was told through Holy Spirit to write it down. And I started speaking over my husband. And I even changed his ID in my cell phone. And it's my wonderful husband. And I would just speak those things out about him. And sure enough, I had been born again for 5 years, but he got born again in Atlanta, Georgia at an Andrew Womack conference, okay? And he is just everything that I spoke over him. He is so good to me. He's always been good to me. So guys, listen, I'm going to sign off here. I hope that you didn't take this as me just wanting to talk about myself, really. But I consider many of you very good friends of mine. And I wanted to give you some more intimate details about my wonderful life being with Keith and my mother and all of these wonderful events around my salvation and my intimate walk with Jesus. So I'm going to get off of here today. I love you. And, you know, tomorrow I'll probably just do a Bible teaching snippet, okay? I'll see you here. Bye-bye.